is one of their mobile kitchens that they actually
is that even some what I call habitual
beautiful Stop and Shop in the Wilton penalty, but it was actually a tax, and that it
Welcome to the Marty Heiser Show. I am so happy you're here tonight. We have an incredible group here. We're trying to model ourselves against that wonderful program on the Fox studio called The Five. And speaking of the Fox studio, you know, really, the Obama administration criticizing Fox News is a lot like the football player who's bad-mouthing the only cheerleader that won't sleep with him. I didn't come up with that. That was our friend Greg Gutfeld. I'll put it over here. Hopefully we'll be able to get some of these as we go. We have an incredible group here this evening, and we're going to be talking about all things. But as we start every show, it starts with a little bit what's on my mind. And as Dave Strait, our crack producer, cameraman, head bottle washer, and in charge of international sales for the Marty Heiser program, pointed out this evening, there was, if you'll recall that press conference that Barack Obama had with, it wasn't Putin, but it was Putin's lapdog. I forget the guy's name. What's his name?
Medvedev.
And Barack Obama got down literally on one knee, grabbed his thigh, which I thought, I don't know, Russian culture, it seemed a little forward to me. He grabbed his thigh, and while he's holding onto the thigh of the leader of Russia, he said off mic, hopefully no one could hear it, said, after this election, I will have more freedom. And Medvedev.
It's
like a hockey player to me. He goes, I will tell Alexander Putin, I will tell him, and it'll be Vladimir Putin. He sounds like a hockey player too. Yeah. So now we're seeing where this feckless, spineless, chocolate eclair, he has a spine of a chocolate eclair. Our presidency and the foreign policy that we're seeing here is getting us. We are the laughing stock of the international community. Syria, you'll recall, breathless talk about gassing and chemical warfare, and this will not stand, and there's a red line, we're gonna cross, this is it. Wait a minute. The wind just blew. Apparently, the Brits aren't going for this. Oh, we need to rethink that. What's that? Congress isn't going for it. What's that? MoveOn.org and all those wacky environmentalists aren't going for it either. Well, let's just scratch the whole thing. Just kidding. What's that? Putin will come in and clear it out? Sounds like a great plan. You know, it's no illusion why New York Post has called this presidency a complete and utter disaster. And I haven't even started with Obamacare. Let's just talk briefly as we sit here on September 13th. March 13th.
You were close. And,
thank you, September. March 13th. It's like single digits out there. And we're talking about this global warming. There hasn't been even one uptick in global warming over the last 15 years. But what the liberal Democrats are saying to us is the way to fix global warming, or maybe it's not warming, maybe it's just changing, that's it. The way to fix climate change is to work harder, work longer, and pay more taxes to liberal Democrats. Because if you give liberal Democrats a bunch of money, they'll solve just about everything. Look at that healthcare.gov. They really did a smash-up job on that. Look at all the trillions of dollars we've spent on poverty in this country over the last 50 years, starting with Johnson, and still the poverty rate is exactly the same. We've got a lot to talk about. I have a bit of a cold, so if my voice gets a little harsh, it may be a blessing to some of you watching, but I will eventually run out of gas. The phone number here is 203-438-2003. You can call in at any time. We'll put you right on the show. We want to hear what you have to say, the good, the bad, and the ugly. If you agree, if you disagree, call in. The number's on there, 438-2003. We don't have a debate tonight. We don't have politicians vying for your attention. It's just wall-to-wall roundtable. And for that, I am pleased to include, I'll just give you the fist pump, Bob MacGuffie, the grand poobah of the conservative group here in
Tea Party.
The Tea Party. By the way, have you been audited by the IRS yet?
Not yet.
What, do you think it's coming?
I'm sure it is.
All right. To give the opposing view, we have Larry Ditkoff, who's joining us.
Thank you, Marty. Good to be back on the show. Thank you for the hat.
Is there anything that you represent? Is there any group that claims you as their leader?
Well, no, Marty, there isn't. But if we're the five, I was wondering if I could be a slimmed down version of Bob Bacall.
Perfect. I can see that. You're suspenders away.
suspenders away from
being that guy. And okay. Speaking of that guy, we have Chris Murray, who is joining us, who is the grand poobah and publisher of the incredible online publication called The Connecticut Patriot. And you brought along Alex Torello, who's a burgeoning political cartoonist.
Very talented.
All right. Very good.
Excuse me. Alex, what made you decide to do political cartoons? And as we do this, we're going to be looking at some of your cartoons.
We had a little newsletter in Brantford, where I'm from. Mm-hmm. And I edited, and I was the managing editor. And what we needed...
Go right ahead.
All right, louder. What we needed was some illustrations, because we were poking fun at our selectmen and our second selectmen.
Okay.
So we figured the best way to do that was poke fun at them, because they were revered in our town.
Yes.
For all the wrong reasons.
Okay.
You know how that works.
I do.
It works. They stay in office forever. They milk the system, and they get away with it. So we figured by poking fun, we would start chopping away at their invincibility.
Okay.
So we did that until it was time for the election. As the election rolled around, the party wanted to ramp down the criticism of the Democrats.
I see.
We decided we weren't taking any orders.
You want to play nice right before the election.
We didn't want to play nice. So I called Chris. I heard he had the Fairfield Patriot. And right away, we made a connection. And I said, I can do some cartooning for you, because I've been working on that with our journal was called Brantford Undercurrents.
Okay.
So that's
now,
how we
now
started.
Now, some of these cartoons, like this is the Trojan horse in the form of...
The Trojan donkey.
And you talk about surprise equity grab. I don't know. Can we get a shot of this? And we're going to go over a couple of these as we go. What are you getting at with your artistic bent on this particular one?
Well, you'll see it's Troy, and the gates are being opened.
Right.
And the donkey is being carried, led through, because right. Everyone says that, don't worry about it, we can always check it after it gets through.
Okay.
The donkey being Obamacare.
Is that the idea? We need to pass this bill in order to know what's in it.
Right. Exactly.
And then surprise.
And there's Boehner and McConnell.
It's coming right all over.
They're in there saying, I'm not worried about what a pleasant face he has, but I'm worried about the other end. And down the other end, you'll see a bomb coming out.
And that's
rear,
okay.
Yes.
All right, now we have one here. Is this our governor and President Obama on this one?
Now, that's one that was filled in, so you're not going to be able to see on Obama's side, the scandals he's involved with. And on Malloy's side, you're going to see his faux pas. And Obama is suggesting to him the best way to deal with this is ignore it and blame the Tea Party.
Blame the Tea Party. There's a lot of that.
Right.
And it's funny. It's not just blame the Tea Party, but it's sort of attack the Tea Party using the IRS. What are your thoughts of that as an American?
Oh, that's a good idea. I mean, if you want to attack someone, is that the best way to do it with a society that doesn't care about it? Individuals that don't worry unless it's in their backyard?
Yeah. I mean, to me, it smacks a little bit of a tin horn dictator down in, you know, Central America somewhere, where if your guy's in office, they can sic the CIA on you, they can sic the IRS on you, or if you're a journalist, you know. Journalists you don't like James Rosen's at Fox News.
Oh, yeah.
You can have NSA move the satellites over and tap their phones. But no wait. There's a Justice Department. We're supposed to rise above. There's supposed to be people that, you know, take a look at some of this stuff and you know, say, hey, there's a Justice Department. But guess what? Eric Holder's at the top of the Justice Department.
It's an injustice.
And that's a box in the house. And that's unbelievable. Caller, do you have something to share here?
You know what, Marty? A great panel tonight. Too bad Dave Streit's not at that table as well. But
He's here. He's here. Believe me, he's here.
Hey, real quick, you touched on the Tea Party, and it was a great segue to my first question. And this one's really a question for Larry, who I love having on your show.
Good to be here. Sure, what is it?
Specifically to you, recently, sure. I think it was this week, Harry Reid went after the Koch brothers.
Yeah.
Or funding, conservative America. How is that any different than George Soros funding the libs?
Yeah,
good question.
Apparently, the ad campaign is something like the GOP has a Coke addiction. It's something I think something like that. A little bit of a play on words of drug addiction.
Yes.
The idea being, going back to the Citizens United case, that there's a big concern about, people funding a lot of causes and there's really no accountability. People don't know, where these monies come from.
Right.
You mentioned global warming previously and, hopefully later in the show I'll have a chance to, rebut some of the other things you said in your monologue. That's one of the things that the Koch brothers, they fund people. And they have
but
large coal interests. I know
the
cause you get to it.
It was about the difference between Koch brothers and your
George Soros,
who's pouring millions of dollars in all this stuff as well.
That's fair. I mean, what do they say?
Checkmate, I believe, is what they say.
No, Marty. The point being, and is one of the problems just with the Citizens United case, that when you have groups and that are funded through individuals to put forth ideals that benefit particular individuals, and those individuals, you don't really know who they are and what their interests are, that should be disclosed.
Like to have a more monolithic, intrusive government that controls who is allowed to have a voice in the public square. And the ones that are going to be in charge are the liberal Democrats, much like we have right now. That's your worldview that you're giving to, say, the young people that will be voting
Marty,
in next year's
Marty,
election.
Marty, I thought it was pretty clear, perhaps not, that you should have disclosures, and it relates to both sides, okay. That if you have large PACs, then we should know, who's funding them.
Hold on.
The implication,
you may have a lifeline here. Go right ahead.
I was going to say, the implication of the question is that
Hold on one second.
That wants to have a voice has a nefarious financial connection.
Yes.
I'd love to have a nefarious financial connection supporting the Connecticut Patriot, but guess what?
Where is my nefarious financial
connection? No, but I don't think that's
the 20 people hotline number?
Who completely volunteer.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what it is.
No, but I don't think that's the case.
Wait a sec. The IRS is, kind of fascistic approach to quelling public debate, carrying the implication that there are, unsavory characters behind us is casting aspersions on a lot of very good people who have the best of intentions about restraining growth in a government that they think is out of control, so that we can afford to have children and pass on an inheritance and have them have successful lives without having to be burdened by a government that serves itself first. This is a very fundamental issue. It's the survival of the country that we're talking about, Larry.
Marty, and Alex, Chris, I'm sorry. I realize I made a mistake in that regard. I think when it came out, and I'll ask you to remain calm, Marty. When it came out, and by the independent, I'll get to the call in a second. Yeah. The inspector general, that also some liberal groups are targeted as well.
Yes.
Then, that was the purpose of investigating 501c4, and that it wasn't just.
The numbers were disproportionate.
They admitted it. It was all about targeting conservatives.
Really? So I see now, Larry, So the IRS
it's always good cover.
Wasn't targeting people that just had the word patriot in them.
That's correct.
Or Tea Party. It,
they also progress or that's
just
right.
Out of curiosity, some of those progressive groups, did they ever get their 501 status approved?
Marty, I'm
telling you. Oh, no, just a question. Did they?
I'll answer that.
You're damn right they did. Yeah. Every single one of them did, including the president's brother that lives under a bridge in Nigeria or something like that. He's got some, you know, fakakta group as well. They got
approved as well.
Little Yiddish, I'm a little
Marty, I could be on the show in
Yiddish,
5 years and you'll still be talking about the IRS.
Yeah, I know. Let's just turn the page.
Are you kidding?
You know, it's not like anyone's going up to Congress and pleading the Fifth again. It's not like the President
blowing
of the United States.
Blowing up to Congress?
Going up to Congress.
Oh, as he said, blowing up Congress.
No.
I'm sorry.
Going up to Congress. No, blowing up to Congress, that's the guy that started Obama's campaign, although I think it was a Weatherman Underground or something like that.
Bill Ayers.
Thank you.
I have a word on the IRS? I mean, since the Tea Parties were targeted, I would submit that if and when all the facts come out, this is a bigger scandal than Watergate.
Why? Absolutely.
Because Watergate was elites spying on elites. This is using the IRS, a coercive arm of the government, to spy on and subvert the free speech opportunities of a segment of the population, the lowest down ordinary citizens who happen to disagree with the administration. That's what occurred.
Isn't this like?
I don't want them spying on liberals. I don't want them coercing liberals.
I don't want them doing any of that.
Yeah. I want the IRS dissolved and let the states fund the federal government. There's no need for an Internal Revenue Service.
Wow.
There is none. And I don't want them being used to attack us and subvert segments of the population.
Marty, we need the same thing to liberal groups.
Marty,
and there was
stop
Bush
it,
in the
Marty.
Office
stop.
Or something like that, I'd be against it. I would.
Marty,
it's un-American.
I mean, I was smacks of Gestapo. Why would you defend Marty, that stuff, though? I mean, really.
You know,
it does. Like,
Marty, I want you to watch this show when it's on YouTube. And then I want you to see what I said, and then you say, why do you defend it? I didn't defend it. I just said that it wasn't solely liberal groups. Okay. It wasn't solely conservative groups.
Well, call her, because there's something.
That doesn't mitigate it.
We have a New York Times writer
not
on the phone here. We need to hear his voice.
All right.
Go right ahead, New York Times publicist.
Was this Eric?
Go right ahead.
I don't publicize.
Okay, but you have, for the record, you have been published in the New York Times, right?
And the only thing I will publicize is my great love and affection for you, Marty, with your beautiful hair, your beautiful wife, and your beautiful teeth.
He's a very good-looking guy.
I do got teeth. Things cost a fortune right there.
First, I was nice to see the Ritual's biggest hate monger, Chris Murray, opening his mouth. But I'll move away from Chris real quickly to the gentleman on the far on the right, Marty's right of you, Marty, Bob, who just said
Bob MacGuffie.
Scandal was bigger than Watergate.
Yes.
If you use the code words, that Watergate was the elite going after the elite.
Exactly.
So you had the President Nixon, I won't even get to his relation with Hoover. You had the President of the United States, who stooped so low and so petty with a bunch of the gang that couldn't shoot straight. The President, criminal behavior. He's lucky he didn't go to prison.
Absolutely.
It was part of my fraud. The IRS for decades has been used by the government to go after particular people, going all the way back to Al Capone. How dare you say that, compare it to elite after elite. I love how, you know, Bush was never called an elite, even though he went to Ivy League schools. First Bush was never called an elite, and he went to Ivy League schools.
They're all elites.
You know,
They're all elites. I carry no water for these people. There's a distinction between the two, and that's why I would put the IRS going after average Americans above the typical nonsense that the elites do to each other.
People who break the law for decades, okay?
There's nobody breaking the law. Eric. You don't even understand the regulation.
Eric, hold on. Eric, I'll let you finish. Eric.
Wait till they spy on you.
Let me just ask, dear caller. Is there any part of your government going after your fellow citizens because of their political expression and coming after them with the IRS? Is there any part of that in your patriotic heart that causes you even the briefest moment of pause?
Yes, I will tell you because I'm the worst patriot. Yeah. By the far right. I'm going to tell you, you know me, Marty, and I'm going to tell you a little story what I did this past weekend, over the weekend in New York.
Eric, we're going to have to close with your story about what you did over the weekend.
Let's close them up.
But go ahead. Right. We're waiting with bated breath. What did you do this weekend, Eric?
I spent 4 hours with the founder and chairman of the Black Panther Party, Bobby Seale.
Wow.
He told me a litany of stories about Mr. Hoover, about the Chicago 7, about the Attica riots. Mr. Seale, if any of your panelists remember.
He was in Congress.
Beat a first-degree murder case in New Haven 44 years ago.
Oh.
Mr. Seale also was a four-year Air Force veteran. Anybody on your panel served in the military?
I didn't.
Yes, Alex Torello served honorably in the military.
Okay, Marie.
Chris Murray was a Cub Scout.
Why are you a patient?
I'm sorry, what?
I'll tell you something. I'll give you one thing about Mr. Snowden. Who I absolutely
Wait. We agreed we were going to end with your weekend. Eric, can I just wrap up? Your point is that the person you spent the weekend with was a member of the Black Panther Party, and they too were targeted by the federal government, correct?
He was the founder and chairman of the Black
Panther. I'm trying to wrap this up for you. Your point is that the Black Panthers were targeted by the federal government, and isn't that reprehensible? That's your point, right?
No, that all came out in the Freedom of Information Act.
Okay, well, I agree with you.
Nixon and John Mitchell.
All right.
That's all news, though.
Okay, Eric, I got to go, because all these guys paid to get in their cars and come down here. We got to hear from them, too.
I want to hear the hate monitor, Chris Murray, talk about it. Go ahead.
Okay, all right. We'll go right to the aforementioned hate monitor. Thanks for the call. What about that? Black Panthers, his weekend. I'm not sure what else he said.
Bobby Rush, not Bobby Seale. That's my mistake.
No, but where are we at with this? With the IRS thing, are we making way too much of a deal out of it? Is it you know, so passe? Do we need to move on, as it were? What do you think? Chris.
How we segue to Bobby Seale and the Black Panther Party.
I'll tell you why, because we're saying we're victims, we're being attacked by the IRS, and his point is, that's been going on for years, all the way back to
it carries with it the implication that what we're saying is right, is that when government takes an aim at its people, it's wrong.
I agree.
And that's my point, whether it's
you're going after a liberal group or a conservative, I think it just smacks of un-Americanism. And I'm disheartened by the vast liberal group that sees, they're not coming after me.
Larry's answer carried with it the very same implication, which is, well, they targeted liberal groups as well. Also something that is reprehensible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Marty, can I say something in it quickly? I was at Yale when Bobby Seale and Angela Davis was there, and she was given a fellowship, and it was so wonderful. And it was a crazy time. But those people murdered. They killed. They were some nasty people. So to compare, compare them with
that's a very good point.
With a conservative group that wants a 501(c) or four is absolutely ridiculous.
Okay. Caller, do you have something to add?
Yeah, Marty, I do. And really, this is a question for the group, including the caller that just came, that was just on the phone. Are these indicators, here's a couple of data points. The 350,000 gun owners in Connecticut that did not register their firearms, is that an indicator of the citizens saying enough is enough and screw you? Also, the recent Florida vote, that the Republican won. I think it was Alex. I can't remember exactly.
David Jolly.
Is that another indicator, for all Americans that they're sick and tired of this crap? Forget elitist, elite versus elite, Nobody likes what the IRS did, at least anybody with a sane brain in their head. But are these indicators of people just being fed up? I'd like to hear from everybody. Thanks, Marty.
All right, Bob, we'll start with you. My answer is I hope
most
so.
Most assuredly.
I hope so.
Well, I think, everybody complains about the conflict today in the country. If the agenda that is being pushed against the will of the people, if they would stop, which they never do, if they would stop it, there wouldn't be any confrontation. There wouldn't be any conflict. There wouldn't be any obstruction. Mm-hmm. We don't want to play along with what's being pushed at us. We're being governed against the will of the governed without the consent of the governed. This is what it looks like. And now they've touched a hot button issue in Connecticut, and they've done it with the wrong group, with the Second Amendment group, and they've gone and they've passed a law to give placebo to grieving people in Newtown and to advance their agenda, and this is what happens. And so they do not learn, though. That's what is a little bit of alarming, because they do not learn from any feedback we provide them, none. They ignore it and keep proceeding. But if they would stop pushing the agenda, everything would be calm in this country. If they would just calm down and stop pushing government down our throats, we'd all be fine.
You know, it's interesting because people say, oh, you know, sometimes on the right, especially the Tea Party groups and some of those groups, you guys are paranoid. You guys are paranoid. Second Amendment, gun rights, you know, you've been saying for years, they're going to come after our guns. They're coming after our guns. They're going to come down, and if you don't hand in your guns, you're going to be considered a felon, a lawbreaker, and they're going to come to your doors and want your guns. And for years, people have been saying, you guys are crazy. You're nuts. It's not going to happen. What is happening in Connecticut right now?
That they're going to come.
Law-abiding gun owners.
Listen, what they do
are
is
in violation of this law that they passed.
Indeed.
And right now, they could be convicted of a felony.
The state
could come to their door and confiscate their guns because somehow people think that these
and the
things are
and the average guy doesn't care because he's not a gun owner. And so then when they come after freedom of religion, they come after religious groups and tell them that they have to provide insurance for procedures that are against their religious beliefs. The other people said they don't care. Those are the religious people. Well, there's an old saying: they come after them, they come after the next ones, they'll come after the unions, they'll come after each segment of the society, and then finally, when they come after you, there'll be nobody there to defend you.
Yeah.
And it's exactly how it works. And let me tell you, folks, they're coming after the 401ks, because if you think when the financial implosion comes, they will leave the stage in shame, they will not. They're going to come after the 401ks, and they started teeing that up this week and started peppering. If you look at Looney going to the microphone and his cohort, they did not look like people that were presenting the best of news to their citizenry. And they're going to tee up a state-run IRA of all things. And it's only been done in the other fabulously solvent state, California. So they start to do it here. Mm-hmm. It's all coming. If they would stop, they wouldn't have conflict. If they continue, they're going to get pushback.
But all this paranoia stuff people were talking about, they're thinking, oh, they're monitoring our phones. They're listening to our email. And people were like, are you crazy? Oh, you guy, you right-wing guys, you know, you're just nuts. Come to find out, they are. Yeah. Who saw this coming?
Tape your computer cameras.
They're targeting because of my political speech. Oh, come on. This is America.
Marty, he wanted to hear from everyone. I want to get a bit to the Florida election. But just one last thing about the IRS. You know, they went after the group's tax-exempt status. It wasn't the individuals themselves who got audited. I'm sure
really?
Some did. Yes. But
that's not true.
I'm not.
False.
Some
not
are. That's so you say. But that's one thing. I want to talk about the Florida.
I want to talk about
the Florida election. The caller asked if they thought the Florida election was a harbinger to come. C.W. Young had held that seat for 21 terms. It's 43. What are you doing?
Upward. I'm scratching my cheek going like this.
Okay. So he'd been in Congress for 43 years. He died in his latest term. It's a heavily Republican district. The vote was 48-46, and there was 4 or 5% for the independent. And then there was a couple of other independents. So the fact that they held on to a seat in a pretty
so
red
like
district. I'm just saying that to the caller's question, I don't think that you can
extrapolate
that.
Okay, so like, for example, that district, did they vote for Obama the last two times out that district?
I don't know.
They did.
They voted for Obama?
They did. Imagine that. And in that district, because I know you got it all from the Democratic playbook that this is.
I got it from the Wall Street Journal, Ron.
Well,
it was 48-46. Yeah,
that district voted for Obama twice in the last overwhelmingly.
They voted for this guy for 21 terms, and he was a pretty right-wing Republican.
Right, but
so
no, this is
ahead.
A replacement of that.
No, right, the replacement. I was saying that district.
Whoops. Yeah, I mean,
get your microphone. We want to get every.
That's fine.
Person.
I mean, you know, anybody's out. Welcome to their delusions. It's fine. We'll see what happens in November.
How
know?
Am I deluded? You know, without my.
All right,
this one,
you might please. You have some thoughts on this, Chris.
Well, you know, in the Patriot. I want to plug the Patriot a little
Absolutely.
Bit. We have 9,000 readers. I have 20 to 25 writers, and I'm not finding it hard to find people who want to write and express themselves.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is a really nice thing. We're kind of modern day pamphleteers. But there's a piece in there. It's a piece of parody, and it's about, it's called Parody or Truth, and it's about what's happened in Connecticut with this gun law and the lack of compliance, shall we say.
Right.
It's a very funny piece. I kind of parodied off a piece on a website called callthecops.com, the 27th most reliable source of law enforcement news. I mean, it's one of these kind of onion type things. But the story, basically, they say, is that the people who are not complying with the law, most of them are policemen.
Is that right?
Well, that's kind of, you can imagine the scenario is very plausible.
Yeah.
So they're trying to figure out how to solve the problem. Well, they want to, we're going to have our law enforcement people go door to door to collect people's guns. But they're the ones who are not complying.
So how many of these are specific rifles that are deemed dangerous? And they, let's just pick a number. There are 100,000 of these, and they sent out notices to 100. No, there are 100,000 people that own these guns, and only 15% have complied by registering.
There's tens of thousands of people who are theoretically in violation of the law right now in Connecticut.
In Connecticut.
Yep.
Okay, so now they sit in violation. The ball's in the overburdening state government's court. What are they going to do?
They're thinking about amnesty, actually, although you're not really seeing it in the newspaper. But the caller made the point. I mean, is this the last straw, so to speak? Because we really don't have government that people are adhering to. Yeah. Finally.
Yeah. Some people have said it's a bit of a turning point.
Yeah, could be.
You know, Marty, a lot of people have said, once Obama came in, that they were going to go in and they were going to go get the guns. But there's really been no legislation at the federal level, no substantial legislation, since he took office.
Well, they tried.
As far as
what is going on right now in this state?
No, I'm talking about on the federal level. You made the point earlier that they're going to come and everyone's going to come get your guns.
Do you know what's going on in the state of Connecticut now?
We're talking about guns that were deemed to be assault.
Oh, assault scary rifles. Looking ones with the pistol handle.
Yeah, I know. I understand that, Marty. Yeah. But you were making the point earlier. I'm not talking about the state of Connecticut.
Yeah.
I'm talking about that in the country. That when people said, you're paranoid that people are going to come get your guns. Yeah. You haven't seen that.
No, I gave three examples. One, I said that the right has said for years, they're going to come after our guns, and we all poo-pooed them and said that will never happen. Yeah. And my point was, it is happening right now in Connecticut.
You're talking about...
My other point was that I said that people were concerned that their phones were being tapped and that things like that were going on. And people said, you're crazy, that's never going to happen.
Yeah.
But it turns out, it does happen.
Yeah, Marty...
That's what I'm saying. These crazy paranoias are finding their way to the front.
Let me jump in on the gun issue, okay, for just one second. So what I want to understand here is, Larry just made the comment that Obama's really not doing much on the gun issue. Actually, he is. He's shipping the guns down to drug lords in Mexico, right? He's arming Al Qaeda in Syria. He's shipping arms to Libyan insurgents. He's going around the globe overthrowing regimes. Meanwhile, he's taking guns away from you to ship them to the drug lords. Makes perfect sense,
Dave.
What he's talking about is this thing that was called Fast and Furious.
Oh, is that what you're talking about?
Well, yeah. Remember where the border guards were killed?
I didn't think he was calling up Ayman al-Zawahiri.
Eric Holder and the Department.
Yeah, I know what it is, Marty. Yeah. It's another
not everyone
talking point.
Went to an Ivy League school and is intelligent.
What is not a talking point? Would be real for you guys?
No.
Really?
I thought we were going to talk about, I'm just saying, things that happened. That didn't necessarily happen. We haven't mentioned Benghazi yet, which I'm surprised.
There's still time.
There's still time. A year ago.
Fast and Furious really happened.
I understand that.
The border guard is really dead.
I understand that.
The gun that was used was really given to
the federal government. Do we do background checks on all those people who are shipping guns to around the world? Do we do background? Do they pay taxes?
I don't know.
Very good point.
Running in Connecticut.
Seven people died because of a gasoline explosion in Harlem.
What does that have to do with anything?
I thought we were going to talk.
Well, 130 people got stabbed to death on a platform in China, a real platform in China.
It was 30 people.
Okay, someone needs to control this. You're going to make a point.
I'm trying to make a point. Is that you talked about things like, you know, rail cars are so dangerous, yet you have just in our own backyard, you know, a pipe. We've talked about pipelines and rail cars before. Now, what I'm saying, you look somewhat quizzical.
Land this plane, Larry.
No,
land
I'm making this point. You're saying things.
It's a drone.
You're saying things about guns and how people should have. And I'm saying that things are dangerous. And you know, Dave, I thought the comment you made about the shooting in Ohio was kind of like way off.
Okay, hold that point.
What shooting in Ohio?
I sent you a
hold that
email.
Point. Caller, do you have something to add?
Went to the bar.
You know what? I do, Marty. Question. Directly for Larry.
Yes, sir.
Larry, I'm going to shamelessly plagiarize.
Please.
A question from a famous Pink Floyd song where they said, "Mother, should I trust the government?" Larry, with all the stuff we're talking about tonight, should I trust the government? Thanks, Marty.
Thank you. No, I mean, you know, the government gets its power from the consent of the governed.
Right.
So, I mean, that's correct. And the answer to your question is no. I mean, people should always be watchful. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't necessarily mean every time that government undertakes some action that it's necessarily that they're, you know, out for some sort of power grab and they're out to diminish you. You know, I know I've mentioned the, you know, going back 50 years, you know, to the Civil Rights Act in 64 and the Voting mm-hmm. Rights Act in 65. You know, people said, you know, we're not going to let the government change, you know, change the way that we live. Mm-hmm. Yet it was government's action that, you know, helped draw or helped change a lot of racial attitudes in this country. Mm-hmm. So,
it was people's action that changed the law. And that's what that's what sustains it, that's the genesis of it, and that's who we are too. We have the ability as people to influence our government. Government is not this kind of
It's not an island. I get it.
Okay.
But I mean, there was so much anger towards, you know, to go into those particular pieces of legislation that, you know, I don't think that's the case. I don't think the country was...
The Democrats opposed it, right?
Yeah, a lot of Democrats opposed it.
Well, Larry, I would submit that was the last really great and useful piece of legislation that was passed in this country. There hasn't been anything since that legislation on a federal basis that's been critical to the fabric of this country.
See, can we pivot?
Good point,
can we pivot
Bob.
To
the last one?
Can we pivot to an NSA Snowden issue for just a second? Is that okay?
By all means. Yeah.
So the height of hypocrisy, and this is what flabbergasts me, is nothing is an issue until it affects you. So Dianne Feinstein, over the course of the last 2 months, when all these allegations have been coming out about eavesdropping and listening and the NSA, she could have cared less, except when they started listening to her. Now the Obama administration's breaking the law and it has to be reined in, and it's totally unacceptable.
Yeah. Well, they said hysterical. With the staff. They said they were listening in on the staff.
It's hysterical.
Well, it's illegal.
But, yeah, I understand.
Right? And nobody cares until it's them. We got to start caring about other people before it gets to us.
Yeah, the Reinhold Niebuhr example that Bob said. The point
first, they came for the socialists.
Yeah,
and I didn't speak up because I wasn't a socialist.
Oh, he's got it right.
Then they came for the trade unionist.
Yeah, I know.
And I didn't speak up because I wasn't a trade unionist. Yeah. Then they came for the Jews. And I didn't speak out because I wasn't a Jew. Then they came for me. And there was no one left to speak for me.
Yeah. He was in a concentration camp, but he survived.
Right. But that's one takeaway I have from that movie, Schindler's List. You know, this was a westernized country. This wasn't some whacked out.
Yeah, I know.
But they went through a really bad economic turmoil.
Yes, they did.
And out of that economic turmoil came this one leader. And he said, "Don't worry, give me the power. I'll take care of your health care. I'll take care of this. I will control the way you communicate.
Did Obama,
I'll make sure."
Did Obama, did he get rid of Congress?
He tries to right now. He's going around Congress.
Did he? He's absolutely going around Congress.
They would never do it in that kind of a strident fashion. It would only be done incrementally, and they came out and said it in the 40s that it will be an incremental. We will march through the institutions, and they've done it, and here they are.
That's my point. My point is that in a time of economic turmoil, which we went through with the Great Recession and
it wasn't worse than Germany in the 20s.
Fair enough. Granted, but the point is, all of a sudden, everyone turns to government, and here comes hope and change. I'm going to take care of everything. And before you know it, you're losing your rights left and right. And you, all of a sudden, you're naked out there, and you go, what happened to our country? What happened to freedom? What happened to rugged individualism? What happened to not looking to government with our hands out going, give me? What happened to that? We built this country. We're Americans. Yeah. We came here because we wanted to say, you know, I'm going to rise and fall on the sweat of my brow. I'm going to try and make a business and make a go of it. I'm not counting on some elites.
Marty, we get it. We get it.
Trying to get on a roll.
We get it.
You know what I'm saying?
We get it. Marty, they said it in the 30s when Social Security came in. They said it in the
No, it wasn't.
They said it in the 60s.
Is it well
funded?
They said it in the 60s.
Social Security's a bust.
Ask the people who rely on it.
There's dependence on it, but there's no money in the pot. They took the money. They stole the money. No.
We're just passing debt on their kids.
There's no money in there. There's no money in the fund.
Time.
Yeah.
There's a Social Security trust fund. That is funded. Don't say there's no money.
There's no money in there. They pay it out of the general fund.
No, that's not true.
Yeah, it is true.
Is it true, Dave?
It is true.
The general,
it is true.
It doesn't earn
any interest or anything.
No, it's not true. Well, they put it.
It doesn't earn anything.
That's
it's gone. Johnson started taking it. They put it in the general fund.
That's not true. That's just flat out
wrong.
It's
the biggest ripoff. It's the only
you're
good.
Flat out. Mistake.
Okay, but we have 15 minutes
really?
Left.
All right.
I want to spend
I answered
minutes.
You last time off camera, and you didn't email me back. I gave you that whole boatload.
For those of you at home, the really great part of this show is what happens after the show. We really should have cameras out here, because you think this is good? There's blood on the ground after this whole thing.
Reality
is over.
TV.
You should really turn it.
Go ahead,
we have 15 minutes left. I want to do 5 minutes on Connecticut. What's going on here? Is it going to be Governor Malloy going forward, or do we have anyone on the Republican side that has, and you know, more of a backbone than a chocolate eclair?
Well, I think it's going to be Foley.
And then 5 minutes on the federal elections, how 2014 is, and then 5 minute lightning round. What do we have going on here in Connecticut? Is there anyone, Tom Malloy, this guy McKinney, anyone that can come up?
Tom Malloy.
Tom Foley, I'm sorry.
Listen, Foley ran against him last time and won a majority of the towns and lost it in the cities with some election irregularities in Bridgeport. You know, he probably could go up and give him another run. Malloy has not.
Is he your guy for governor?
Yeah, of those there, yeah, probably.
So
yeah.
you Tea Party types going to come out and, you know, with your tri hats and your flags?
Probably.
You know.
I mean, not all. We don't move as a monolith, but.
It's a big tent, though. It's inclusive.
Yeah, I mean.
It's better than the guy
we got
now. I mean,
Dan Malloy can't get over 50%. He's a nasty man. I mean, did you see what he said about us? I challenged him in the town hall, and all he does is deflect. He tells me about global warming. So he believes in the weather, and he tells me to queue up for a free mammogram. That was his answer for him disparaging the Tea Party. he called us barbarians at the walls. That tells a lot about him. He believes he's over the wall on the other side, and he doesn't care about throwing some of his constituents under the bus.
I have a question actually to the people on the Tea Party. I'll address it to you, Bob, and you know, maybe some callers have it come in, and Alex and Chuck as well. It seems to me, you know, there are all these challenges on the far right. Mitch McConnell, for example, you know, in Kentucky. And a lot of times when they get these extremists in, like a Sharon Engel in Delaware, the woman who was the witch.
She was in Nevada.
The woman who was the witch.
Right,
O'Donnell.
Christine O'Donnell.
So my question is, do you think you're actually helping the country, or do you think you're just putting in races, Democrats
Larry,
where people...
Larry,
we're helping. You put up the poster children of faulty candidates, and everybody loves to point at those, but there were five Senate seats that were won by Tea Party people. And You didn't say Aiken, but any of them do. Aiken wasn't the Tea Party guy.
Well, Aiken was
you can point to our losers, and I'll take them. I'll take you know a few losers anytime. The rest are all rhinos, and they lost all over the country. And the scorecard that in
well,
10
but they
and
lost,
12,
lost some red states. You know, Donnelly in Indiana.
No, Donnelly.
He won. He was a Democrat who won. Clem McCaskill should have been beat.
Right, that was Aiken. Yeah, that, was Aiken. Wasn't a Tea Party person. Everybody says right? It was. It's all part of the propaganda.
Okay.
Larry, when you ask a question, and when the prior caller with his vitriol towards me, when you ask a question and you use the word extremist, it's very deceitful. It's very deceitful and dishonest. You seek to gain control over the conversation by the legitimacy of your question. I don't accept the premise of the question and the premise of the language you use. An extremist, I don't know what an extremist is.
They blow up police stations.
There you go.
No, an extremist is one who
disagrees with you. That's an extremist.
That's being ad hominem. An extremist is one who has views that are shared by a very small portion.
When you use language like that, and when I say you seek to gain control over the question dishonestly, you take weaker people or people who with less, a little bit less resolve, but believe what I believe, and you force them to self-censor, even though they continue to believe very good things, and they just want their country to have less government and they want more freedom. It's inimical, excuse me, to the conversation to use language like that.
Alex, when you said you
I don't know. I got to tell you, I don't hear you.
We're going to Alex.
I don't hear you saying that to Marty.
Well, Larry,
when he goes on.
Well,
yeah,
he doesn't
Larry,
say
you
extremist.
Said that an extremist is someone who believes in not what the mainstream.
That's
believes.
Not what I said.
You
a
said
small.
Some,
I said
small
a small portion.
Okay, a small portion. Small portion. Do you think the vast majority of the people are right in Nazi Germany? Was the vast majority of the people right, or were the few extremists?
Well, in the Nazis' case, they
Hitler
were,
was
oh,
democratically
an exception.
Elected.
Hitler was democratically elected. Yeah. They were very weak, and a lot of them turned their back, and they knew
so
it was wrong.
So you believe in the majority. I have a cartoon here of people jumping over a cliff.
All right. Show it to them.
Because they think they're doing the right thing.
But I'm saying the people in Germany, I don't think they were doing the right thing. They were just afraid. But go ahead.
It's a mob mentality.
But no, but I think what he's saying is
says we're out of step. Oh, here we go. Says he's out of step with the mainstream.
I think what he's saying is that in our democracy, I mean, we live in Connecticut. Let's be honest. It's the bluest of blue states. I mean, it's never going to be. Pretty,
it's got
know,
the blues.
I'm a conservative Republican here. Like there's like five of us right now. You know, and if a grenade went off in this room, I would fear for the Republican Party. There aren't that many.
No.
But I think what we're saying as Americans is that we deserve a seat at the table, and we deserve to have our voices heard, and we deserve to not have an oppressive federal government come down on us simply because of our political speech.
Well,
and that's
the
ground rules of this country.
Yeah, I know that, Marty.
Okay, so
but
that's
no, what I'm saying. I'm saying is, does the Tea Party scare off, I mean, there are
scare off
a lot of moderates who ordinarily would vote GOP.
What are moderates? You mean the undecided?
Independents.
We call them the youths, the uninformed. That's what you're talking about.
So much for
what's scary, other than what the media says about Tea Party people, they're average people standing out on a corner talking about the Constitution and waving flags. What is scary about them, other than what the media says about them?
You know, some of the things about, we got to deport,
Larry,
you know, the
12. Have you ever been to a Tea Party gathering?
No.
You're at
you
one, have, my friend.
You really should go to one, because my first one was in New Haven, the hotbed of liberalism. But you should have heard one person coming from the audience after another, what they were saying. You would say, how do these guys know so much? How are they so bright? And there wasn't one bit of hate speech.
The funny thing is, I mean, Dave drags me out to these things. Like Obama's speaking in Stanford or something. Well, let's get a camera. It's in our opening scenes here. You know, we're interviewing
people.
You know, we interviewed just a sampling of the crowd. Minorities.
I saw
that.
I saw him on. Yeah,
first
I know.
Generation
minorities
immigrants.
And immigrants.
So. Yeah.
Eastern Europeans.
Eastern Europeans are all these immigrants.
There's a reason.
You know,
and they're like, you know, and the funny thing is,
Marty, a lot of African.
Let me finish.
Okay. Go ahead, Marty.
the classic, you know, criticism of the Tea Party is you're somehow anti-immigration and somehow anti-minority. You go to these rallies, I promise you, one was a minority who's a foreigner, you know, well, like this black guy with an accent.
Yeah.
I'm
so,
like, oh, where are you from? I don't think that...
You know, Marty, I've seen like GOP conventions and, you know, the meetings, and they show, you know, they pan the crowd and they show people. And I can remember one time that, you know, they show an African-American guy, you know, a black man at a GOP meeting, and then they show him again, and then they show him again, because he was pretty much like the only one. I'm not saying that there aren't, you know, minorities in the Tea Party. I'm saying the overwhelming majority, you know, of, you know, look at the polls.
Black, didn't even say that.
Black conservatives in this country are vilified by the liberal left.
Yes, they are.
They are hated.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I know that.
All right, we're getting to the lightning round here. Dave? You got a lot on your mind.
Well, we're going to talk about climate change for a second.
Okay, let's go with climate change. And
there you go.
Go right ahead.
So if there was a drug that was in phase two testing, and 98% of the people that took the drug, they had adverse effects, negative reactions, do you think, as a taxpayer, you'd be willing to spend billions of dollars to continue to finance that drug? Most people would say absolutely not. So my question is this. Why, when over the last 20 years, 98% of all international weather models that were proponents of global warming proved to be dead wrong, should we continue to pour money into this fiasco?
I think it's because it allows liberal Democrats to control more of your
life
and your money.
And I'm going to pivot and switch gears back to the Russian situation, because I don't think we gave that justice. Okay.
We haven't said a word about it.
Right.
I said that our president was grabbing the inner thigh of a world leader.
Yeah.
Oh, Marty, in a dialogue.
But let's
don't
roll.
Don't worry, I'll tell Vladimir after the election.
Yeah.
You'll have more freedom.
So let's.
Sorry, Ukraine, you're screwed up on that one.
So let's roll the videotape back a little further. When Sarah Palin said, hey, Obama wouldn't know what to do if Russia invaded the Ukraine, the liberals scoffed.
Oh,
when Mitt Romney in the debate said that, hey, look, Russia's not our friend, everybody scoffed.
Hey, Mitt, the 80s called. They want their foreign policy back.
Right? And Obama said, hey, the Cold War is over.
Yeah, it's really funny.
He leans in and gives a little pat on the thigh and said, oh, tell Putin we'd be okay.
Yeah.
Right? And then the State Department comes out and says, oh, by the way, we spent $5 billion to overthrow the government of the Ukraine, and we call it democratization. Mm-hmm. Now we've created a fiasco, and we don't know what to do. We created the mess.
Well, I mean,
and there's no accountability.
Luckily, we're a democracy, and enough
Republic.
People can eventually kind of dissuade themselves that this hope and change nonsense just ain't really panning out. And maybe we should go back to just a little bit more, you know, free enterprise capitalism. Yeah. It did pretty good for a long time.
I just wanted to give a plug to the paper, okay? It's the Connecticut Patriot. We come out monthly. I have 9,000 readers and growing. It's a statewide publication. We cover everything.
It's a force.
So if you Google Connecticut Patriot, it'll come up?
The Connecticut Patriot, or you can email me at editor@thectpatriot.com, and I will give you a platform, you can send me your material, and it'll be seen by 9,000 readers and growing.
There
so,
you, go.
You have got something to say?
And there's something about global warming in here. My buddy Glenn wrote about global warming. One of the most successful times in history, when the dinosaurs were huge and big, it was global warming.
Yeah.
When it's cold, it's famine.
Yeah.
So he writes a great article. So
my wife has said that from the beginning. He was right over
she
there.
She did?
Very camera shy. But she said the same thing. I mean, in the Middle Ages, they had like 3 harvests a year because there was so much global warming. And then when George Washington was trying to occupy New York, it was so cold during the Revolutionary War that the New York Harbor froze over.
Yeah.
You could ride a horse across the New York Harbor. What's the point? The point is the temperature ebbs and flows.
Yeah.
You ever heard of the Ice Age? You know all these stone walls around here? That's because we were covered with glaciers. But guess what happened? Global warming. Yeah. And it rescinded. It's not because
that doesn't fit the narrative.
Marty,
Republicans driving SUVs and we need
Marty, it's something like 17 of the 20 coldest winters have happened over the last 30. I mean, it's something. I don't have the exact statistics.
17 of the last 20 coldest winters.
Out of the 20 coldest winters in the past 100 or something years, 17 have happened. It's something in the
that
last
kind of
20
years.
There's global warming?
Well, that's, yeah. Well, in other words, if you're saying that If you're saying the Industrial Revolution started about 1740, more or less, and there's been a there has been an impact on the planet.
Okay.
And if you're making the point that there's no impact or limited impact based upon man-made behavior, then I think you're right.
Okay, what do we do?
Give more money to liberal Democrats.
No, we can't get China to comply, and the developing nations are the ones that create most of it. What do we do? We sacrifice our own standard of living and still suffer the consequences of China not complying.
Well, yeah,
you got to ask the next question, not the political question, the scientific question. That's what you got to ask, okay?
I think the answer is work harder, pay more taxes to liberal Democrats.
Pull that wagon.
Marty, that's your answer. And by the way, phase two trials are done by private companies, not the government.
For the viewers they want to help a good conservative, Mark Greenberg's running for Congress in this viewing area.
In which district?
Which district?
In the 5th District, of course. Yeah, absolutely. So look at Mark Greenberg on the internet, and he's running in the 5th District, Danbury to Waterbury. Help him out. He's going to make it this time.
I also believe that Tom Foley is going to make it this time. I do.
Tom Foley for governor?
Yes,
that's
I
who
think
we're
he's
behind.
Make
hey,
it. Yes,
he's
a good man.
He's ducking us. We had a really nice debate set up right here. His schedule, he's looking into it. Can you tell Tom Foley he should,
I'll see what I can do.
Show up here?
Yeah,
that's
really
what
nice.
I say.
You ought to show up everywhere.
Alex, final thoughts.
My final thoughts are this is a wonderful show, and I want to thank Larry.
Yeah.
You're a great sport.
And everybody else with very intelligent conversations. It was a pleasure to be here.
Well, thank you. Listen, Cheryl, one of the people that help out on the show, sent me this question. She said, can you judge all Muslims by the atrocities of a few? What's the answer to that question? No, you can't. Now, my question is, can you judge all gun owners by the atrocities of some whacked out, essentially mentally insane people? Is that really fair? I don't think it is. It's not fair to judge all Muslims by the action of a few terrorists, and it's certainly not right to judge all gun owners by the actions of a few insane people. So on that thought, thank you very much for watching the show, and appreciate all the callers that called in. Tune in next week. We may have some candidates running for governors. If they're man enough to man up and come in here, we've gotten positive statements from some of them. Tony Boucher is going to go back to the state Senate. But some of the other ones, McKinney, Foley, some of these other guys, let's clear up those schedules and come on in because the people want to know. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week on The Marty Heiser Show. Good night.